interview with the clinic where you were conceived. And we were just hoping all of us in the room here, including your brother, Isaac, and mom, and your dad, and Dr. Nelson, and the student studying Yogi. Medicine, Yogi, just basically to give you a quick rundown of what happened as far as this in vitro fertilization. How did this work?
Well, let's see. We had your mother in, she had ultrasounds all the time to make sure that her ovaries made lots and lots of eggs. So one of those eggs had to get together with sperm, of course, and we didn't want that just to be left to chance, so we put the sperm right inside the egg. Then in the laboratory, you were swimming around in a little dish just like this with your last name on it. And only the people who have the microscopes could see you, because they're so tiny you can't even see you. And then out of one of those eggs and one of those sperm, there was an embryo that went inside this little squiggly catheter that went right inside your mother's uterus. And now we can see on your first picture, your first portrait here, that you're swimming around in a bunch of black fluid. And that's basically the first time that we could really see you without the microscope.
Thank you, Dr. Nelson. Okay. My understanding is that Emily's ovaries, like most women's, are about the size of a walnut, but then with all of the fertility drugs, which try to produce as many eggs as possible, they can get as large as a small, a large orange, possibly. I mean, a lot of swelling happens because of follicles forming.
Mm-hmm.
And a follicle is like a little grape-like pimple, you could say, on the outside of the ovary that's mostly fluid with the egg on the inside.
Right.
And then with the HCG shot, there's a those are loosened, I suppose, and then the doctors go in through surgery through the vaginal cul-de-sac and stick a large tube and fiber optic and vacuum cleaner in there and suck it out.
Collect those
and collect.
Eggs.
And in this case, I believe they collected about 33 or so. There were 33 so follicles, and they may have collected around 22 eggs, and then found that there were about 18 viable eggs, which mm-hmm. they did ICSI on, which is the intracytoplasmic sperm injection.
Right.
And then observed those for maybe a half a day or a day and found that there were about four that were viable. In
right.
other words, four that were strong enough to go ahead and implant. And the window of, or how would I describe this? I guess the protocol is roughly 4 to 6 embryos for implantation. Now they know is about when you'll get a one gestational versus multiple gestational things, which we don't want. And if there were extra above and beyond that, then they would consider freezing or
right.
whatever the family wanted. But in this case, for Valentine, she and three of her siblings, there were four of them that were viable. Roughly 5, 6, 7 celled at about that
usually
stage.
About between 6 and 8.
Yep. 6 and 8 cells.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, then the laboratory used this pipette deal and put them right in and then watched them
right.
for the last couple months just to watch her grow.
And right, and only one, for some reason, decided to develop, which is
mm-hmm.
good.
Mm-hmm.
She won't have to share any of her toys or anything except with her brother.
That's right.
And it could be a he. You know,
that's right. We don't know. We're just using this for conversational
right.
sake.
We don't want them to get any bad feelings.
And part of that procedure, too, while she's still and her siblings were under the microscope as, are they called blastocytes at that point?
Yeah. Well, they're still embryos.
Still embryos,
yeah.
but in the laboratory, in the petri dish. And they actually do a assisted hatching, is that the right term?
Mm-hmm.
Where they actually slice the hardened cover of the embryo, the first stage, to help it grow and expand.
Yeah, I mean, some pictures. I don't know if you can
sure.
focus.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But after they put the sperm in, like you said, with a needle, the outside gets really hard, almost mm-hmm. like an eggshell, really. Not that hard, but it's pretty hard.
Mm-hmm.
And normally, when the eggs float through the fallopian tube, that would soften up, and when it gets to the uterus, everything would just open up. But the lab's probably not quite as good as the body, so we can instead just cut a hole in that edge.
I see. That's the assisted hatching
That's
there?
That's the assisted hatching part.
Oh, okay.
And that then these cells, which is the embryo, they just move out there and just go right into the uterus.
I see.
So.
Well, this has been very helpful.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Nelson.
All right.
Thank
so
you
we're
to the whole
supposed
clinic.
To see you on June 10th, if not before.
All right. We'll try to get a picture for you.
Okay.
Thanks.
Sounds good.
What? I'd really like to listen to this.
Cindy, what kind of work did you do today? What kind of work were you doing today?
I put up some walls. And
is that like drywall?
Yeah, so you know, you rocking? Measure and you cut it, and you hammer it in.
Cool. What kind of work did you do today?
I was hanging some ceilings today.
How do you do that?
Just hold them up there and then nail them.
Huh? Cool. Is it hard work?
Yeah, it's a little tiring.
Of course not.
Alan, what were you doing today?
I was chilling.
Chilling? Cool.
And I was doing the drywall too.
Alan was all cheesed up.
Alan was all cheesed up.
What's that stuff called?
She rocks.
She rocks. Molly, were you sheetrocking today? You guys, what was there good music during sheetrocking?
Oh, yeah. Always.
Why can't we have the CD player?
Because we're veteran sheetrockers.
And Bridge, what were you doing today?
Oh.
Katie, you were pretty much in charge of the whole project, weren't you?
Katie hammered like a whole 3 nails.
But they were nailed well.
Put in a, did a good job before and she rocked in a bathroom.
I had to make sure everybody else was doing good.
Good time.
Cindy, you think this job here in the house will get done today?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Cool. Oh, you're done.
Oh, that means you can bring the CD player down by us.
Well, I think there's going to be some taping and mud. What do you call it when you put the spackling?
We're done with the drywall.
Cool. Kind of work you guys been doing today?
I'm doing insulating the bottom of this house.
What's that mean?
On my back, I've been crawling around.
Making sure the puddles.
Crawling around on my back, insulating and getting really itchy.
What are the masks for?
Insulation, when you put it up, you're on your back and you put it up and you post it in, so it falls down, so you know. You gotta be careful, because you don't want to get in your eyes or on your mouth.
Can you also do outpatient surgery for people?
That's what the gloves are for.
Oh.
Give me a screwdriver, Matty. I'll cut you up.
Is it hard work?
It's not too bad. It's just a little wet under the house, so we're getting a little wet.
It's easier than yesterday.
It's a lot easier than yesterday.
Well, we're going back to that when we're done.
Yeah, although we're
thank you.
Going to
landscape
when we're done.
It's all right, bye.
Hi.
Hi.
What'd you guys do today?
We spackled and taped the wall.
Could you show us what that means?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, this is spackling. And then Emily will tape it.
Don't flip it anymore. Just let me catch it.
Where is the seat?
Hey, what'd you guys do with Zeppelin?
Don't know Zeppelin.
Yeah, it's just like
seriously.
Guys, the hell
happened?
Cutest,
more than
two
reasons.
Oh.
Mark and Katie and Megan are working so hard.
Oh, yes.
I see. So yesterday you guys all nailed these sheetrocks up.
All this is just the frame. And then we nailed it all up.
And then you put the tape on.
All the nails so that they don't fall out.
Oh, I see. And so that makes the wall smooth. Is that the idea?
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, when this is all done, what do we do? Paint it?
Make sure your eyes are nice. Yes. 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 Everything is done. Now,
oh, yes. Please.
This is the great job that Mal and I did. See how smooth it is?
Oh. Yes.
And our little friend here.
Megan, Ryan, Cindy, and I.
And see this? Yeah, there's a hole right there that's a hole that Ryan
that's
made.
A hole that Ryan punched.
Guys are really aggressive.
And spackling would be a lot easier if people such as Bridget Kalacki didn't go throwing stuff at you.
This is good.
The ceiling here, that's my
work right there. Beautiful. And what'd you guys do last night? Did you go to a lake?
We went to the lake.
Martin Fork
went
swimming.
On the boat.
Oh, and Bodie.
I went on the boat.
It was fun.
Well, cool. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
We're now leaving the home they just described and going to a couple other homes where the crews are working. Here they're putting up soffit. It's the underside of the overhang. Keeps bugs and other animals from getting inside the house. See what these guys are doing. This home. Got more in the back room. See what's up. Hey, Boone. You're doing a good job here, sir.
Thank you, sir.
These guys are putting in drywall. Once they get all the drywall up in there and spackle like the other home. Explain what's going on here. Is this
putting up the drywall?
Oh, cool. You guys do this whole room?
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah, see you now.
Hey, Will. Hey, guys. Put all of this in. Hey, could you guys introduce yourselves?
Lonnie Thomas.
Deacon William B. Greer.
Conrad Thomas.
As you know, the Loyola group's been up here working. What do you think? How's it going?
Very well.
Any difficult things, anything break, anything major bad happen?
No? It rained.
It rained? All right.
Slippery, a little muddy.
I understand the school group here has a large supply of cookies. Is that good or bad?
Yes. It's sort of good, sort of bad. Because there are a lot of cookie breaks.
Thanks, you guys, for your help.
All right.
Thank you.
Your moral support.
Here's Bridget.
What's up?
Wow.
We put up the entire
deck. I built a house today.
Good job, guys.
Sure.
Hi, what you been doing today?
We were doing a little bit of everything. Oh. A little hammering, softening, putting up sheetrock.
Which house you been working on?
I've been switching back and forth in this house up here.
Oh, okay.
And this house where yesterday I had to insulate the underneath.
Oh man, what was that like?
More or less a dungeon.
Wet, damp, dark.
Oh, it was really
itchy.
Wet. It was itchy, it was cold, it was cramped.
Yeah.
Other than that, it was alright.
How's it going for you?
Good. I enjoyed it last year and I'm having a good time this year.
Amen. Thank you.
Good.
DJ, what you been doing today?
Today I used a drill to put holes in the 2x4s for the wiring so they could get the electricity going through the house.
Hey, we need a hole right here too, dude.
Switch to switch.
Can you show us one of the places you did that?
Sure, I've got a hole right here. Just walked up on the ladder, drilled down straight through. On some of them over here where the roof comes down, had to stand under and drill up. And that's where you got a little messy. When she was falling down on you. But it was a lot of fun. Hard work for 4 hours.
How's it been going so far?
Excellent. We've not much for everyone to do here, but I was lucky to get a job.
Cool.
This morning on a half day.
You've been having fun?
Definitely.
All right.
Definitely a lot of fun.
Thanks, DJ.
No problem.
Close your eyes in slumber, do you think that God will say, you've earned one more tomorrow by the work that you did then? And the second poem is by a lady named Sherry Lee, who a few years ago, she was having trouble because she lived in a trailer and she had a young child and she'd leave the back door open for a little bit of ventilation. She didn't have any air conditioning. The baby would actually crawl out the back door and fall. It was about a 4 foot drop. I did it a few times. So she went over to this place called Kynes Creek. She was a really proud woman. And she asked me, you know, can you build me a porch on the back so my baby doesn't fall? I said, yeah, you know, no problem. Send guys over. So they sent a Loyola crew over. They go to this porch, and in return, it's called doing. Today, let me do for another, be it ever so humble, small. Lend a hand, lend an ear. Let me hear their unspoken call. For when I give myself, my pleasure is the greatest of all, knowing I'm eased in others' load, be it ever so great or small. For it's impossible to give more than you receive. When I fling my giving to the wind, it returns double to me. This is my second trip down, and the first one went so well, I decided to come back down for another one. And I talked with you guys before, just how there's like a special feeling when you get back here, like you miss it, because it just, I don't know, there's a certain feeling when you give. And I remember last year I was working on the house, and this couple comes up to the house, and I'm sitting under there, and I'm putting the piping up there. I see him come up, so I kind of slide under, take a look out. They look at this house, it was this tiny house. I mean, it was a rehab job, so it wasn't anything beautiful. But their faces just lit up, because like it was going to be their house, and they were going to live in it. And like all of a sudden, there was this unbelievable rush that came over me. Just because I knew that I was doing something for these people who didn't have anything. And because of what I was doing, they didn't have a house. They didn't have a place to live. And by my simple acts, it was making their life better. Basically, you're going to do just reflections on what you've seen, what you've done, and everyone has a chance to talk. You don't have to talk if you don't want to, and we're just going to go around and share. So I open it up to you.
Well, the first day got here, I was pretty excited. I really didn't know what to expect, and when we got to the site, it wasn't what I thought it was, but with the hills and all the trees, it just seemed to fit together, all the houses and everything. And the group I was in, we did sheetrock the first day, and it was so cool. And at least for me, is that there was these rooms, and there were no walls on them, just studs. And by the end of the day, we had all the walls covered, and it just seemed like you really did something. Started to see it was a house. It wasn't just, you know, some lumber put together. It made me feel like I actually did something, and, you know, one day that, you know, these people would be using these rooms and calling it home. And then another side is, you know, today some of us went into town, and you know, people you've never met will talk to you for 20 minutes about their life and ask you where you're from. And it seems like you've known them for all your whole life, and you've just met them for 5 minutes. I thought it was so cool. I mean, back in the city, none of this would ever happen. People wouldn't spend the time to talk to you, but here they will.
Besides having just like your sense of accomplishment, just watching like what you've built throughout the day, I really enjoy how at nighttime we all come from different groups, different home lives, different like beliefs and stuff, and we're able to like sit down with somebody who you would never even like look at school, and like have a really good conversation with them, and get to know them a lot better.
I think it's just amazing what I've seen in these people that really have basically nothing. Like, I mean, when we first drove through this town, over there, I honestly thought it was, like, abandoned, like, trailer homes. Like, they're not only trailer homes, but, I mean, things are just, I mean, you've seen the houses, they're just horrible. And then you see these people sitting on their porch waving to you as you go by. And, like, that, to me, is just unbelievable because, I mean, we go back to Chicago or wherever we live, and our biggest problem is, you know, like, I'm so stressed out because I have, like, this to study for or whatever, like, he said this, and da, 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 and it's just, it's all a joke compared to, like, what these people have to deal with. Like someone said before, it's, for us, it's where you're going to college, and everyone's stressed out about that, but, like, for these guys, it's like, how am I going to get money for next week's food, you know? And I think just the problems that we have at home, or we think are problems, are just nothing compared to this. Like, everyone here is just, from what I've, in my experience this week, I've found that I am just so blessed and, like, so lucky to even just have a house and just to be able to come on this trip and, like, with all these people. And, like, this guy, William, the carpenter today, or the other day, was, like, talking about how he's trying to raise, like, his 11-year-old and his 13-year-old sons, and he's worried about the education they're getting and all this, and he was saying how he's not going to move yet because he wants to stay and, like, help out his mom, who's, like, been sick for the last couple of years, but he really wants to move. And he was even saying how he could have gone on this trip to Europe, and he gave it up for, like, 2 weeks or however long it was, and he gave it up because he wanted to stay home and help his mom, like, get through, and he wants to see her die, and he wants to be there until she does. And how many of us, like, go on a vacation or whatever, even when we have a sick grandparent? Like, we just don't appreciate family. Like, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but when I go home, and, like, if I have to spend time with my family, sometimes it's great, but usually I'm thinking, like, I hope I get to go out tonight, or, like, I got all this homework to do, I don't want to sit down and have dinner, like, I'm all stressed out. These people, they'll do anything for their family, and I think that's a big thing. They just appreciate all the relationships that they have here, and just every little thing they have, they're always happy with really nothing.
I've noticed that money doesn't play an important role in, like, the people's lives here. Like, when I was talking to some of the carpenters, like William, he was saying how his wife kind of, like, snickered at him when she asked him, like, oh, are you going to be working for COAP again this year? And he's like, well, yeah. And she's like, you know, that doesn't make a lot of money. But he's like, but he told us that it really, he could have taken a job that made twice as much money, but he would just rather be working for people that can't afford the housing and, like, helping other people out because he feels better himself. And, like, many people around here, they're so, like, into, like, spirituality and, like, God. And I heard there's, like, 40-some churches just in Harlan or around this area. And, like, people just have, more, like, more laid-back atmosphere and, like, ambience around here. And they're not as stressed out as we are because they don't make a big deal out of little things like we do. Even just stuff like school. Like, we get so worked up and they just, I mean, they care. But they know that they have to be, like, they have to have, like, inner peace and just, like, you know, rest in order to have, like, a successful, content life.
First experience of Harlan, and I kept a journal last year at Cranks Creek, and this was my first day of working on. Every day gets better here in Harlan, and each day is fun, hard, laborsome, important, significant, and special. The morning started with about a 3.5-3 mile run, where I tried to keep in shape and get ready for football. Breakfast preceded our long and confusing trip to Dorothy Williams' home. Here, I painted and scraped the wooden shingles of her house. It got messy, but we did a good job. As usual, I spent a lot of time trying to get every spot like a perfectionist. But before I forget, I went this morning to get paint with Missile, and I really experienced poverty for the first time as I stepped inside for the smelliest, smallest, most decaying and wet box, which some lady called her home. I didn't understand at first why we were concerned about painting the outside.